membership to Mint, Swarajya, The Wall Street Journal, Financial Times, The Indian Express, and other publications. Rajiv sir graduated with a BS in Materials Science and Engineering from Northwest University and an MBA from Columbia University, specializing in private equity and value investing. We can also catch him on Twitter by the name @RMantri. We welcome you, sir. I also introduce Mr. Harsh Gupta Madhusudan, sir. He is an Indian-based public markets investor. Sir has written extensively on economics, finance, and politics for Mint, Swarajya, The Wall Street Journal, The Indian Express, and other publications. Sir enrolled to study at IIT Delhi before dropping out. He graduated from Dartmouth College with an AB degree in economics. He also holds an MBA from INSEAD. We can also follow him on Twitter by the name @ Harsh Madhusudan. Now, I would like to hand over the session to the speakers.
Okay. Thank you so much, Aditi. Thank you to the Orange City Literature Fest organizers based in Nagpur and elsewhere. Thank you for this unique opportunity. I think by the organizers had asked us whether we would want a moderator or not. And since we've already done so many sessions on the book by now, many webinars and so on and virtual lit fests, we thought it would be interesting for a change not to have a moderator. Not that Rajiv and I need moderating, no pun intended, but it would just be useful for us to, just chat for 30, 40 minutes. If there are any later questions, then you can just flag it and, tell us. We just thought we'll just chat on how, what we see are the contemporary issues. We'll talk about the book. We'll talk about how our views evolved. And we'll just keep it a dialogue instead of like, proper webinar or a monologue. So Rajiv, do you want to start?
Yeah, sure. So let me just begin by giving a very brief overview of the book. Maybe many of the audience members have had a chance to read it, but I'll just give a very quick overview. So the main thesis, if I had to summarize, of the book is that India was not created in 1947, but that India, which the ancient name of Bharat is also obviously our country is known by, India, that is Bharat, is actually an ancient civilization that is transforming into a modern nation through the agency of a sovereign democratic state. So what we have seen since we gained independence in 1947 is that different sections of society through social movements, different governments are all trying to aid this transformation of the country. And that has obviously been with all kinds of challenges and all kinds of pressures. There have been some disappointments. But by and large, I think India over the last 75 years has done not too badly. Much more could have gone wrong. But luckily, India has avoided those kind of disasters. And here we are today, almost 75 years after independence. We still have a very vibrant democracy. We still have a very vibrant sort of value system in our public culture, where ideas are debated. Platforms like the Orange City Lit Fest and many others are there today, where there's an open threadbare debate on issues across the board. So when we look to our West and to our East, that's something for India to be very proud of. Not many countries in this part of the world can claim to have that. So the core thesis in that way has been that this transformation to a modern nation state has been underway for 75 years, and different political groups, different parties have contributed their own ideas to this transformation. And we were told about 25 years ago that there is the idea of India, and there is this singular kind of representation of what India is, what India should be. And we were given that as a kind of unquestionable kind of, absolute sort of truism almost. But Harsh tried to put the position that there is not one idea of India. There are many ideas of India. And we have provided, or we have offered in our book, one particular version, which takes a view that individual rights are paramount, which takes a view that kind of a liberal economy approach, freedom of sort of association in an economic sense is very important, rather than the kind of socialistic approach to economy. And we also take the view that India should take a kind of leadership role, both in this region, that is the Southeast Asia, South Asia, generally speaking, Asian region, as well as in larger world affairs, because India, at the end of the day, is home to 1/6 of humanity. And so it is imperative that India should pull its weight. We have a lot at stake in the world. And to be totally blunt about it, we haven't really sort of pulled our weight for the most part in the last 60, 70 years. So in sum, I think on those three planks, that India was not invented in 1947. India needs to take a more free market, liberal economy approach. And India also needs to speak up for its rights, both on the world stage as well as in the region. I think those three are three critical planks. Obviously, there are many more themes in the book and we can discuss as we go along this session.
So thank you so much, Rajiv. I think that's an excellent introduction of our book. You know, this viewers, this is the book. A New Idea of India. You can see the subtitle is Individual Rights in a Civilizational State. And you know, I'll just begin by very briefly, and Rajiv can add more later on. The cover. So this is from the original Constitution copy of India, and this is a photo of Lord Ram, Sita, Lakshman. From the fundamental rights section. And therefore, we wanted to kind of show, just to add to Rajiv's point, that, you know, India is a civilizational republic. It's an ancient civilization and a young republic. I would just request, Rajiv, just put on mute once. I think it's just echoing. And then when you speak, I'll also go on mute and vice versa. So it's a civilizational republic. And, you know, the reason why this is interesting is, you know, people today would associate the figure of Lord Ram with the so-called right wing, right, with the BJP party. But obviously, you know, Ram is, you know, all of India's, and that is the consensus. There's nothing called the BJP in 1947. Even the Jan Sangh, the forerunner of the BJP, was formed later. So this was, you know, which is why the first chapter is called India, that is Bharat, which are literally the first words of the Constitution as well. So the Constitution understands, not just presupposes, but recognizes a pre-existing entity called Bharat. Right? Now, that entity was never one unified state, certainly not in any modern sense, right? But it has clearly been a civilization. So, you know, the things that he says, as Rajiv mentioned, this ancient civilization is now becoming even more coherent into a modern nation. But the civilization was always there. You know, one of the books I encourage everybody to read is Dina X, A Sacred Geography, which basically says that all these Hindu pilgrimages and other pilgrimages, but largely Hindu pilgrimages across India, would take somebody from the south of India to the north, from east to west. And therefore, in somehow mapping our sacred places, we would all be interconnected to each other. And that process of interconnection is what we are saying is actually deepening in modern India. So for example, you know, it's very common for people, their parents, to have the native village in one state, the mother's native village in the other state, they themselves being born in another city, having studied in yet another city and working in yet another city, and so on and so forth. And you marry across caste or region or language. And that is becoming more and more common. I'm not saying it is the majority yet, but we're already seeing that in the middle class and upper middle class, younger demographic, people who have white collar jobs. It's not that uncommon to see anymore. And it is, therefore, to that extent, even though the basic underlying idea is ancient, of, you know, seeing the whole cosmos as one, but to the extent that it's happening to that level, it's a new idea. And because there is intermixing happening again, perhaps after centuries, so there, in that sense, it's a new idea because that is leading to much deeper coherence. So it's now, you know, when people, just to put it more provocatively, the two Punjabs are not in the same country. You know, there is a Punjab in Pakistan, there is Punjab in India. There are two Bengals. One is in India, one is in now the country called Bangladesh, earlier called East Pakistan. But somehow Jammu and Tamil Nadu are very happy being in the same country. And similarly, Gujarat and Assam are happy being in the same country. So it's not just an accident of colonialism. There is obviously some path dependence to that. You know, some people say why Nepal and Bhutan are separate, and we kind of hint at that. But you know, maybe India chose to keep them as buffer states with an potentially aggressive and now actually aggressive China. But largely, if you look at this kind of diamond-shaped country, there is a huge coherence to it. And now, why does this matter? This matters is because that is what the constitution makers also understood. That yes, they're trying to have a social revolution in India. In that, to that extent, the state was an intervening state. It wasn't a classical liberal state, especially after the First Amendment of Nehru. But that social engineering was also happening on a pre-existing entity. Now, what unfortunately, those founding fathers, so to speak, not of the country or the civilization, but of the republic, the founding fathers of the republic did was they did not extend that so-called liberal attitude to all communities. They, for example, did not have a uniform civil code. They interfered only in the majority Hindu community with the subtext or the unsaid argument being said, we are Hindus, and therefore we can kind of socially engineer aspects of Hinduism. It would be wrong for us to do it for, say, Islam or Christianity. But our argument is, if that is the case, how then do we cohere into one nation? That's what we call the soft bigotry of low expectations. Like either, you're publicly saying you're Indian, but even the Nehruvian Congress, people effectively saw themselves as Hindus first, of a different kind, perhaps more reformist than quote-unquote communal. But because they did not extend that individual rights to everybody, which is what we want to do, eventually they also had to forget, consciously or subconsciously, that India was a civilizational state. And we are only bringing that back, both in terms of society and politics, but also in terms of economics. I mean, free markets, we have an exception for that in the case of Atmanirbhar Bharat. We discussed that with a lot of nuance. But by and large, there should be free markets. What is free markets? It's individual rights in economics. It's individual freedom to transact, to buy and sell, to start a factory, to close a factory, to hire and to fire. And for a long time, one of the other chapters in the book is called Profit is Not a Dirty Word, which is effectively responding to what our first prime minister famously or rather infamously told J.R.D. Tata, Jay, do not talk to me about profit. Profit is a dirty word. And we say profit is not a dirty word because profit is, what some economists would call the signal, the incentive, the motivator for entrepreneurs to say, well, there is high profit in this industry. All of you should rush here, cut prices, increase quality, make more money, and the customers are also better off. Again, I'm not saying the picture is always as simple as that. There are exceptions which we discuss. We need regulation and so on and so forth. But as a simple default, that picture is true. But even that picture was not accepted for a long time. We had all kind of ceiling acts, land ceiling acts, rural, urban. If you had to expand capacity in a factory, you had to go to Delhi to get a license permit. And therefore, a license permit Raj word happened. And basically, our entrepreneurial energies got throttled. And entrepreneurs were not thinking of how to win in the marketplace. They were thinking of how to win in the bureaucracy place, how to bribe the right people and get the right connections and the licenses so that they could keep their competitors out. And therefore the mindset in a genuine
management environment as it was called.
Yeah. I mean, famously Bill Gates once said that, I'm more concerned about Washington state than Washington DC, but effectively, we all had to start managing the capital, political capital instead of financial capital. And that led to our entrepreneurs having a zero-sum mindset that, we can't win together. If he wins, I lose, because growth was low. And so insultingly, they would call that growth Hindu rate of growth, as if it was India's, as Sanjeev Sanyal, our mentor and the person who wrote the foreword, he said, as if India's cultural moorings are to blame for the bad policies of Jawaharlal Nehru and especially Indira Gandhi in terms of economics, especially, as if these policies are not to fault. But it is India's ancient culture itself which is to fault. So I think now that we've both kind of given our summaries, I think we'll have a more casual to and fro, perhaps. Rajiv, what area would you like to discuss? And we can now interject each other, perhaps.
Yeah, so one of the key things, Harsh, like we pick up in chapter 4, is on how the topic of legibility. So for a long time, even under sort of colonial rule, the ruling authority in the country didn't have that kind of legibility, right? So legibility meaning the state being able to know who its citizens are and the citizens knowing, who the government is and having that kind of a interaction between the two. So, and obviously the colonial rulers were exploitative. They came to sort of almost loot India in a way, and send sort of capital back to the home country port. But after independence also for 60, 70 years, for a long time, there was always this problem of how should, for example, government target sort of welfare? How should government regulate an industry? Because to regulate an industry, first you have to know who's operating in the industry, who are the people in it. And those people need to be sort of identified. Those firms need to be identified. There needs to be, you know, the dreaded paperwork, right? What we all dread in the private sector, that there is paperwork. But what we are seeing actually in the last 6-8 years in particular is with the rise of digitization, many of these things have become much, much simpler. So I thought we should discuss that aspect.
I think that's a fascinating point. I'll just kind of quickly go to and fro there. I think before, just to explain to the audience, legibility, as in the state knows who the citizens are, where they live, historically, how much land do they own. Because, you know, historically, all taxes were agricultural, right? Because most people were farmers and they were ranchers, and people would not know. So what would the colonial state do to, for example, the Mughals? They would have local kind of tax harvesters. They would, and they in turn, so they would outsource it to these nobles, this nobility, which in turn, and therefore they kind of continued under the British under the Zamindari system. And therefore people often, you know, we've discussed this separately also, Rajiv, in other countries also, people had a first name. Many people did not have a last name also. You know, they knew their Gotra, their caste Gotra, but they did not have a last name because, you know, in that particular small world, they did not need an additional small name. So somebody would leave Junjunu and become Junjunwala when they come to Calcutta. Or, you know, there are so many Parsi names like that. But it's only when you actually become a part of a larger economy do you need a second name. Because, you know, Harsh and Rajiv by themselves might be common names. And now, because it's even more complex, even, you know, Harsh Gupta is not a common enough name, perhaps. Oh, sorry, it's too common a name. Therefore, you need an Aadhaar ID and so on and so forth to have these internet, you know. Maybe that's one of the reasons why I have a pen name of Madhusudan. So I think it's very interesting to kind of pinpoint that, how, you know, the British were the first to begin penetration of Indian villages. And they kind of reduced the arms, took away the arms of the farmers, which even the Muslim Turkic rulers did not over centuries or could not. The Britishers did that.
It was all this obviously was driven with the aim to collect taxes.
Absolutely.
For which they placed
more and more.
They placed agents, right? So there were agents and probably multiple layers of agents between the state and the citizen. And the whole object was to collect taxes. And over time, that
machinery. There can be no modern state without a.
Yeah. And over time, that machinery, you know, that extractive machinery was not kind of reformed or modernized even after the British left. So you know, thus we have the dreaded sort of aspect of paperwork. Many things are done which should not be done also. But there are important roles of a state which should be done, but which India has probably done poorly till the advent of digitization. So that aspect of digitization in government and in society has made a very big difference, as we lay out in the book, in terms of efficacy in government, in terms of stopping the proverbial leakages, you know, what we call leakages, in terms of, you know, there's corruption, we call that leakage now, right? But having legibility cuts leakage. And, you know, there's more bang for the buck for all taxpayers.
Okay, no, I fully agree. Yeah, I fully agree there, Rajiv. I mean, somehow, you know, it is important to understand that while the word bureaucratic today has a negative connotation, there can be no modern state without a bureaucracy. I mean, you kind of forget that. Like, a bureaucracy is a necessary evil. It's just that you have to make it more and more responsive. You have to incentivize it better. You have to make it less corrupt and more efficient. But there can, the fact that there is a bureaucracy means that you probably have a modern state. Because, you know, the only thing worse than an inefficient state is no state. You know, which is what we kind of, the inside joke running, we often discuss is that if you want a quasi-anarchist libertarian paradise, you should go to Somalia. right? I mean, the world's most well-run places actually have very big governments. The issue is, how do you make those governments limited from the point of view of citizens, and you make them strong but limited? So I think that is something that legibility really gets at, and I think that is something that you and I have written in this book, which is, I would say, relatively less discussed, especially in the context of technology. This is not just any one particular party's contribution, although of course Mr. Modi has put a lot of focus on this, but technocrats who were earlier allied to the Congress party, for example, like Nandan Nilekani, they did the groundwork for this digital infrastructure, for what he calls digital public goods. Now, the only thing is, we need to make sure that the back end of it is safe and secure and privacy is maintained, you know, through legislation, through judiciary, through actual resources. So, Rajiv, do you have something to add on that? Because a lot of people are very paranoid on that aspect, on the privacy aspect.
Yeah, so my view on that is, sure, you know, there are real dangers in you know, government sort of obviously surveilling and tracking possibly everything that a citizen is doing. But having said that, we do have to be mindful of what the trade-offs are. So there are a lot of benefits to sort of having this. There are downsides, but those downsides can be kind of limited through proper safeguards, through checks and balances. For example, if let's say certain government agencies need access to what could be construed as kind of personal data, then that should go through a relevant sort of court procedure if required. It should be requiring a proper approval from a third party authority within the state. Agents to do what they want.
Basically, we need checks and balances. We basically need many more checks and balances. And I think it's fair to say, nonetheless, that the government should have access to the metadata. Right? I mean, the metadata is something, the collective data, which allows them to see patterns without exposing any government official to seeing direct individual data. So I think metadata, or big data rather, can also be something very interesting there. I mean, the Chinese are coming out with a central.
Yeah, but even for purposes of security and policing, for example.
I think the internet is a bit slow. I think is it on me, on my side, or on Rajiv's side, or Orange City side?
Mine is working fine. I think I lost you there, Harsh, for a second, but now you're back. No, I was saying, even from the perspective for the use of policing and security, I don't think there should be checks and balances, but given the kinds of threats also which we now have, so the same tools which enable conveniences also create new types of threats. So while we are using those new amenities and conveniences, we shouldn't cut the state off from deploying the same tools for sort of public protection and security. So I don't think any country has figured this out yet. Any country or any government has figured it out yet. It is a debate that probably every single democracy is having. If you're not a democracy, obviously it's not a debate. But I think all major democracies are debating this. But I do believe that India should not close its eyes to the possibilities of what can be done with digitization on the grounds of, you know, sort of holding up some kind of almost theoretical level of privacy, which frankly no one has ever had in India.
No, I tend to agree with that. I was even more interesting, and this is slightly away from the book, is, you know, now the Chinese have come out with a central bank digital currency, right? The CBDC, like the People's Bank of China. And, you know, this is partly in response to the Bitcoins of the world and the Facebook Librarium, or whatever the name of the currency, proposed currency was, Libra. So I think it's interesting at some point that the Indians will also probably have a central bank digital currency, you know, maybe after China and some countries in the West. And theoretically, if you have a central bank digital currency, that the level of data the government could, again, theoretically have, could be much more than even with Aadhaar. And then the question is, like, you know, it would be very interesting how it kind of, okay, the Chinese as an authoritarian state do not care about privacy, that's fine. But it would be interesting how the Western countries, Japan and India, kind of respond to that? And I mean, as you said, we probably don't have any easy or clear-cut answers on that point yet. But to not compete in that space would also be foolish, perhaps. So, I think it's an exciting area of public policy to discuss on separately. But, you know, the funny thing is, and the way it connects to the book is, once you have all the data, even though we naturally have an aversion to social engineering, and something we have not written in the book directly, but, you know, you could pass so many policies, for example, which could not have been passed otherwise. For example, instead of directly having a uniform civil code, you could give incentives to people who also register under the Special Marriage Act. You know, it's kind of a de facto UCC. If you know people's data and their income tax records and all that so easily, you could incentivize them to do that. So there are many ways in which this kind of tech-enabled economic policies could also actually be used for social ends. The Chinese are already doing it for their social credit system, which is kind of a dystopian, authoritarian kind of surveillance system. But I think more versions of that, more response to that, could pass in India as well. I mean, it's already happening in the US to some extent.
In the last 5 minutes now, I think.
Yes, sir.
Yes, so I think
let's
digitization. Digitization. I think India should embrace. The beauty of digitization is that instead of making the trade-off between efficiency or diversity, you know, one of the kind of now sort of less embraced definitions of a nation state, it always included homogeneity, right? So what digitization enables is you have efficiency and diversity. It's not an either or. Where you know, having different languages, having sort of almost kind of socio-cultural barriers, if you can call it that, to put it crudely, that also doesn't matter or matters far less in a highly digitized society. So I would say India should embrace actually wholeheartedly digitization in both government and business, and it really has so much potential to be transformative in all kinds of domains. So we can summarize now, Harsh, to close.
Go ahead, you do it first.
Yeah, so even in the book, Harsh and I both believe that the next few decades promise to be the most exciting in the long and very old history of India, that is Bharat. We feel that India is poised now for a sustained period of high growth. The high growth will not only sort of make India more prosperous and more secure, it will also erase many social divisions that have plagued our country. So our generation, for example, has seen less of those. The generation, two generations before us, the generation that lived through partition, obviously saw the worst of it. And then the post-independence generation, you know, the generation of our parents maybe, they also experienced a different kind of society than what we have today. And these things are changing rapidly, not least because of sustained growth, because of India's transition from a poor country to a, you know, lower middle class country to increasingly probably approaching middle income status, maybe in, let's say, 8 to 10 years. And maybe even we can aspire to even becoming a very rich country, provided we are able to invent our way.
Yeah, so
to prosperity.
No, I'll just quickly add by taking I'll just summarize also. I'll take a very brief but even longer historical lens, saying that for even looking at the parts of the world which are now part of the Indian Republic, those geographical areas, large parts or at least a significant part was under foreign rule in one way or the other for 750 years. And finally, the Indic or Dharmic civilization has one unified, massive nation state, democratically run, not very efficient, but getting better continuously. And we are very bullish on the economics of it. And we think that the politics in society cannot be disconnected from the economics of it. I think growth will lead to larger female emancipation, financial independence of women, more intermingling of people, and creation of a much more coherent nation that still respects diversity, as Rajiv rightly mentioned. And I think on that note, we'll leave it there. Thank you so much for organizing this thing, Aditi and the entire team from City Literature Fest. Rajiv, should we show the book once again and take a screenshot maybe?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much for inviting us.
Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful and informative session. On behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Our next session is from 4 p.m. with Mini Vaidya on Women Breaking New Grounds from ISRO to Unsung Heroes. Thank you. Please stay with us.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 20 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions. A vision beyond.